thanks very much to the organising committee for the opportunity to present at this conference. In this talk, we're going to discuss the illustration that you see on this front slide, which shows an optically detected magnetic resonance experiment. These lines in red represent laser beams for optical detection. Optical detection rather than RF inductive detection is becoming quite popular in magnetic resonance for low frequency NMR pickup, say fields 100 times less to 100 times higher than Earth's field. And I'm going to discuss these in the context of field cycling, the subject of this session, by showing you some measurements that we've done that are currently hard, if not impossible, to do with more standard techniques, these that you see here. And I'd like to illustrate that main idea with this picture. So starting from a sensitivity point of view, optical magnetometers, which I'm going to use interchangeably with alkali vapor magnetometers, tend to outperform RF coil detection of NMR below the Earth's field. So that's more comparable with squid magnetometers, but OPMs are significantly more compact and mobile. And although OPMs have been around for quite some years now, they're still very rapidly advancing, and the potential is still very much becoming realized, such as in zero-field NMR. And we and some other groups have been investigating the potential of these detectors together with magnetic field cycling. So as you know, many properties of magnetic resonance systems depend on magnetic field, both coherent and incoherent. And these lead to many NMR phenomena depending on field, for example, spin relaxation. And if we study the field dependence of that, we can gain insight into the corresponding molecular property, molecular dynamics. And the field dependence of coherent dynamics, like polarization transfer, is also often studied versus field to understand mechanisms. And clearly this is a very simplified picture, but this is just to show what field cycling is all about. So field cycling is an experimental strategy that helps us probe the dependence of NMR over a wide field range on a single instrument. That's not very easy, while keeping all other experimental aspects as constant as possible. So something like this could be done with switchable electromagnets to measure relaxation rates T1. But it's not ideal for sub-Earth field measurements. So usually background fields need to be compensated for ambient field and for drifts. And then after the relaxation delay, you have to very accurately switch back up to a field where the signal is within the bandwidth of the detector. So we ask if OPMs can help us out. Maybe the field cycling could be done this way, so detecting at the low field. And as I'll show you, there are some situations where this approach may be helpful or advantageous to investigate NMR effects in the ultra-low field, as well as being fairly easy to apply in practice. So I asked the question whether ultra-low field detection is tame, because OPM technology has been around for some time. If you go back in the literature, the use of atomic media to detect magnetic fields goes back to the 60s, with things like the atomic oscillator, and then these really became serious competitors against squids in the 2000s. Thanks to the discovery of the high-density surf effect. And then since then, they've quite rapidly increased in technology readiness because of applications in brain imaging. Because if you can make OPMs small enough, say with MEMS technology, that they can be placed in arrays on the body, they can image biological currents. Previously, this has been done with squids, but unlike squids, OPMs don't have to be fixed inside a cryostat. They're actually wearable. Let's also quickly remind ourselves that atomic vapors often combined with nuclear spins like helium-3 and gyroscopes to produce hyperpolarized xenon-129, which is used in lung imaging. So at least with that hindsight, you could argue it was inevitable that OPMs would be used for NMR. So here you just have to separate the spin species into two different boxes. You're detecting the magnetic field produced at the atoms by the polarized nuclei, the magnetic field of the polarized nuclei. And that's what was done in the early 2000s by several labs, notably these guys, first, in fact, with polarized xenon, then water, and then later salt compounds. And then we fast forward to now. So again, thanks to MEG, it's very easy to detect NMR in ultra-low field because you can just buy an OPM. This one here, made by Q-Spin, is tiny, it's handheld, so this black box contains laser, photodiode, atomic cell, etc. And here you just put that next to a solenoid coil, which contains against the NMR sample. The solenoid provides the magnetic field, and so the diagram on the top left corresponds something like this to the photograph. And then we put that assembly inside a magnetic shield, and then you can fluidically shuttle in a liquid sample where a nucleus spins pre-polarized remotely, say in a high-field magnet. And here you see a syringe that pushes the liquid from the magnet into a flow cell inside the solenoid. And that way you can detect NMR at normal frequencies up to, say, a few hundred hertz. Beyond that, you're limited by the dynamic range of the OPM, which can really only tolerate a couple of hundred nanotesla of stray field from the solenoid. And then that detection is done by tipping the Z magnetization of the nuclei into the plane by with a pulse, and then the OPM axis you make in the plane of the normal precession, so something like this. And now that shuttling is slow, so we really wanted to avoid. That's why we built this fast field cycling system, where all of the nuclei are pre-polarized in situ with a solenoid coil, so water cooled, which is only about 20 millitesla, but nevertheless. Signal to noise is very acceptable. And also, we're using a two-beam OPM strategy. Two-beam OPM is very easily tunable up to kilohertz normal frequencies. And I'm deliberately sparing you the details of that for now, because I recommend that you see these YouTube links where I already explain that, how that works. That's a whole separate talk. But given these capabilities, what can fast field cycling with ultra-low field detection do? Well, the first thing that we looked at was relaxometry, seeing that the dead time was around 10 milliseconds, and that the fields could be reliably switched between nanotesla and millitesla, so that corresponds to an operating range of this green zone here. This is very complementary to existing relaxometry strategies like electromagnetic fast field cycling, the stellar variety, and sample shuttling in blue, both of which involve high field inductive coil detection. And one illustration of new insight that this provides is this system of alkanes in porous gamma lumina and titania. This was done in collaboration with the Magnetic Resonance Center in Cambridge. And here we're investigating the longitudinal relaxation, so T1, of nuclear spins in the liquid caused by the pore surface, which is very large. It's about 100 or 200 square meters for this 1 gram sample. And the pore size is around 7 to 10 nanometers, so that translates to around only a few hundred to 1,000 molecules per pore. And what we can see here in the gamma lumina in this top curve are some distinct features which are missed with conventional relaxometry. The one, for example, is an inverse square root dependence, the power law dependence of T1 on fields between around 100 hertz and 10 kilohertz of normal frequency. And also below, say, 30 hertz, we reach a plateau where T1 is constant, or say a zero field regime where the relaxation mechanism is always fast with respect to the proton normal frequency. And so the curve here, this fit, is called a stretched Lorentzian function. It's stretched because the power law, you know, goes as b to the minus a half, not b to the minus 2 that you'd normally expect for a random based relaxation process. That exponent is actually very characteristic of surface processes, maybe very generic even in physics. So to show you a very basic model of that, that could explain this type of behavior. This is a 1D random walk where there's a molecule that can walk along this periodic vertical coordinate from 0 to 1, and in doing so, it experiences some binary-valued potential, V, which is 0 when the molecule is in this white zone, and it's 1 when it's in this green zone. Then this potential could represent relaxation sites on the surface, say with the surface of green. But we don't actually have to assume any more about the system. If you simply look at the two-time autocorrelation function of this potential. So that's the expected change in the potential after a given time tau. That gives a stretched exponential or an anomalous correlation function. So this process is non-Markovian. And that can lead to stretched Lorentzian type behavior in the frequency domain. Of course, if you want to tie that up properly, you need to do some spin dynamics modeling. So you just choose your formalism of choice. And then make some assumptions about the system. And now that you have a measurement capability for the full frequency dependence of T1, then maybe you can find out which of those assumptions are correct. And I won't go into further detail on that. This model fitting process is something we're working on, but in this case, we think that these effects are consistent with paramagnetic surface sites, when the lumina is known to have some ferrous impurities. We've also done bulk liquids, so these are very easy. Here we're measuring T1 at different fields for water protons in different solutions of this paramagnetic nitroxide compound from Tempol. I really wanted to show you a live experiment, but it was too slow. So in this panel, you're seeing a live experiment sped up, and you see that in only minutes we have a good estimation of T1 in a 5 millimolar solution around 400 hertz. So that's this data point up here. And we can also do that if we put the same sample in a titanium tube, and that's because the signal frequencies are so low that we have little to no eddy currents in the metal. There's no significant attenuation of the NMR signal. That's in contrast to detection of NMR at megahertz frequencies, where this type of measurement would not be possible unless we had a TR coil inside the tube. So here we expect some nice applications shortly, like relaxometry of high pressure fluids or screening of products sealed in metal. You also note that we're doing some fixed field relaxometry, a detection of the relaxation fields. So we also have information on T2 star, which is useful to know, and T2. And here we're seeing that T1 tends to T2 at the lowest frequencies. So we have true natural line lengths. Another comment on detection in the relaxation field with natural line widths is the lines are narrow enough to resolve different components from one another spectroscopically, such as by spin couplings to carbon-13, like in this mixture of formic acid and acetic acid, which we detected a few years ago using zero-field NMR. And as our OPM can now detect up to kilohertz frequencies, we tried this experiment again, this time with carbon-13 methanol, to see the CH3 and OH proton signals. Or at least above Earth's field, the CH3 signals are split by the carbon-hydrogen coupling of about 140 hertz. That's very easily resolved from OH, given the line width is only about a hertz. And then you could do T1 relaxometry with that, but in this case we decided to try T2 star relaxometry. So here we're going down in field. We found this transition in orange particularly interesting, where at low fields this line gets particularly narrow, so it's at least twice as narrow as the other CH3 peak and even the OH peak. We think this is due to some partial cancelling of the relaxation mechanism, because this coherence is a singlet triplet transition analogous to long-lived homonuclear coherences that are seen in some high-field NMR experiments. And then finally, relaxation near zero field is not without difficulties, even in the control environment of a magnetic shield. So one potential source of trouble for measuring T1 near zero field is perpendicular fields, which are a few tens of nanotesla, maybe even in an unshimmed shield. And these cause Larmor precession during the relaxation delay and generally just result in a false measurement of T1. So like here, even for plain water, where you'd expect relaxation rate to be constant, there's somehow an enormous increase near zero field. And while you can try to shim out the X and Y fields with magnetic coils, this is generally very tedious. It has to be done every time the shield is opened to change a sample. And since you have to shim all three components, it's very lengthy. And you can, as you can see, that even field differences of nanotesla make quite a difference to the apparent relaxation rate. In this plot, there's just a factor of 2 in the average over this shaded region. But I wouldn't be telling you that if there wasn't an easier solution. So you can just average out the unwanted field of the pulse sequence. In this case, we're using a pulse sequence called XY4. This is one of the most popular dynamical decoupling sequences in NMR. And it's made up of trains of equally spaced pi pulses. So we just fill the relaxation delay with XY4, and the relaxation delay returns to a constant. So why does this work, and what does it really mean? Well, if you look at something called average Hamiltonian theory, then you can find out that one cycle of XY4 averages out linear spin operators. So Ix, Iy, and Iz here in this this table. This table shows how each operator transforms after successive pulses in XY4. And you can see by adding up the columns that they make a zero. So this really means that we have an effective zero field during the relaxation delay. We should be careful here, though, because an effective zero field for the coherent dynamics is not the same as zero field for the relaxation. The relaxation field, strictly speaking, is the magnitude of all three field components. We normally just take Z because it dominates, but here we'll be limited by the residual of the X and Y parts. But nevertheless, spin decoupling seems a very neat trick to apply within fast field cycling to control unwanted fields. Okay, so let's sum up. We just saw that several ways that magnetometers could be used together with fast field cycling, mostly to measure relaxation. Sensitivity is okay, good enough for bulk liquids without excessive averaging. It's comparable to conventional field cycling. And we've seen several interesting effects on relaxation, like slow dynamics in porous systems. These definitely need modeling. High-resolution relaxometry, T2 relaxometry, and some decoupling that also need some further work. They also need some adoption by you. So in our minds, this is definitely a wild and fun area to work in.